No Depression magazine has praised Will Overman as having a unique trademark voice that you recognize and gravitate to. He's received comparisons to some of his influences like the Avid Brothers and Jason Isbell, and he shared the stage with notable acts like Robert Randolph, Carbon Leaf, Yarn, and the Barefoot Movement. Charlottesville-based singer-songwriter Will Overman, thanks for chatting with us today.
It's good to be here. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, I hope we're finding you well. I mean, we can't complain about the weather, so that's one positive thing, right?
Exactly. No, it's been probably the nicest spring I can remember.
Excellent. Well, a few questions for you. You know, you fronted a band until 2017 when you decided to go solo. Can you talk a little bit about working with a band versus being a solo artist?
Yeah, definitely. First off, it was a huge transition. I toured with those guys for roughly 3 to 4 years. And when you're in a band, you kind of form this kinship and you get to go on stage every night and you trust the guy or gal to your right and left. And there's a confidence that comes with that. So it was a huge change in so many ways. I mean, live, it was different. I had to kind of readjust how I had confidence playing shows. Cause I couldn't just depend on somebody next to me to know my material through and through. I hadn't played X amount of shows with them over the years and just formed this kind of this organic bond with them. And then business wise on the back end of music that people don't tend to see as much, it was a big shift because I took on pretty much everything. Now granted, a big reason I did shift from band to solo was because I felt like I was already doing a lot of that and it just made sense to kind of knock band off the name and make it my own endeavor artistically and from a business standpoint as well. So those were the two big things. It was, I had to shoulder everything, not only financially, not only as a small business, but getting up and performing, I had to hire people out and it made me honestly a better musician because I had to start communicating to musicians better because I would basically hired guns per show, make charts for them, send them recordings, say, hey, do your homework. Let's rehearse once and let's get up on stage and play the show. And that was a big shift for me because I had been used to playing shows. The folks who we just would get up on stage and kind of take it for granted. It's like, of course, we know these songs. We know this set. We've worked this out over so many shows over time. And now I meet with musicians who are great musicians and it's forced me to play with people who are better than I am, which is great because that makes me a better player. But it definitely was a struggle for a bit and it was kind of trial by fire.
Yeah, I can imagine it's definitely revealing. I've had other artists tell me that even if they're still in a band, when they do a solo album, it's very revealing because you start to realize who wrote what even in the band previously, or you start to hear their influences individually. So I think it really brings your voice front and center, not only in your solo stuff, but I could probably look back at a lot of the band stuff and go, okay, I think that strongly was Will's influence right there.
Oh, absolutely. And it shed a light on those places in the songs that I wasn't adding to. So it made me, especially in the recording process, think, okay, Will, where are the holes now that you don't have these players that you had before, or these artists adding their influence, and how can I fill them in with my voice, be it instrumentally, melodically, with my vocals, et cetera. And I'm still figuring that out.
Yeah. I mean, it's quite a feat. I think it's something that the more you do, the better you'll get, but that's not one of your only interests, right? Like I've heard that besides music, you are really into nature and photography. Like you've even hiked the entire Appalachian Trail, which is just insane.
I have.
Do you want to talk a little bit about any correlation you find between nature and being a solo artist and hiking and photography?
Yeah, absolutely. I think part of the correlation between my interest in the outdoors and hiking and being out in the woods by myself is that the more music I make, the more I realize how much of an individualist I am. And not that I don't love being on stage with fellow musicians and sharing that. And God knows I miss that so much right now. But I think I came to a point when I went quote unquote solo where I realized that I wanted to have full control. I wanted the art to be of me, from me, and I wanted to be able to make the decisions on the back end as well. And I think a lot of that is tied into my love of being outside. I mean, I love walking in the woods alone. I hike the Appalachian Trail almost all solo. My wife, or then girlfriend, joined me for about a month. My dad joined me on and off. But I love doing that, and I love having individual control. And like you said, I'm into photography. I love things that I feel like I have control over. So artistically with music, there's totally correlation there. And then as far as I'm trying to think of a way to like bridge that gap, because photography and music, I love photography and I love music. And I think why I love them together so much is that I have a great outlet through the world of audio, art, and music. And then I've got an outlet with visual art, with photography. And photography, I don't try and make a living from it. So there's nice to have this balance to art and music, whereas I'm always trying to push music, always trying to make a sustainable career out of it. And with photography, completely different medium. It allows me to use my brain in a different way, and there's no pressure behind it.
Well, and for me, like when I think about the two, because I'm not a good photographer, I think part of it is, you know, the composition of both, you know, music and photos. They both require some planning, it seems like, but they both kind of also require you to kind of think on your feet, right? Like, there's just different variables you can't plan for, even if you plan for them, like when it comes to hiking.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think the best photographers I know and the best outdoorsmen I know are the people who have considered all factors and have done, you know, cost-benefit analysis and risk assessment, all the above, and are adaptable. Because I think that ties into music too. It's my manager, Evan, and I talk a lot about, let's prepare the most we absolutely can, because things will go wrong. Whether it's getting to a show late or hitting traffic or blow a tire or a musician can't make it or something else goes terribly wrong. It's all about preparation, because things will inevitably happen. And whether that's being outside for me or taking a photo or composing an album cover, single artwork, or being on stage, all those things require that preparation and require that artistic ability to look at something and try and make the best of it. And it's really cool right now, because I'm doing everything on my end on creating this album rollout that I'm working on. And with COVID, my manager and I have really internalized everything. And that's because a lot of people don't want to come out and shoot, and that's fine. I completely understand that. And my day job, I work at a production company, so I film video as well. So I've taken all these different interests I have and different skills, and I'm doing the entire promotional rollout right now for my album. So when you talk about using the same, you know, composition area in your brain, it's absolutely tying into my music.
No, that makes all the sense in the world. And I think that kind of leads me to my next question about it, especially hearing about what you do for a living, is you just released a beautiful and uplifting single called Living Wage. Really can't speak enough about that. I'm sure Bill will post that all over our Facebook. We both have been listening to it, but it resonates for me for certain reasons. And I just wanted to know from you, you know, from your perspective, what the song means to you.
Yeah. Well, first off, I'm so glad you like the song. That song, I wrote it when my wife and I were living in North Carolina. We had kind of uprooted from Charlottesville and gone down there for her career, and leaving my music network and really just my personal network of family and friends at Charlottesville really left me kind of just, it pushed me out of my comfort zone, to say the least. And I had a hard time finding work down there. I was in a weird place with music. I didn't know if I wanted to pursue it professionally anymore. I was really burnt out. This was right after leaving the band, and we had just been going hard. I felt like I was shouldering more than everyone else, and I was kind of embittered by music. So I was in a weird place artistically, personally, financially. And I wrote that song during all of this, and my wife would go to work, and she was paying the bills and working her butt off. And I was just feeling really low. And I think feeling something that people, all artists or people who work in any area in the artistic creative world, have felt, where they're trying to make a living doing what they love and are trying to gauge how much they want to put into that, how much they're willing to sacrifice, and all those huge insurmountable questions that we come across. And Living Wage really captures that. It was kind of me telling myself, you know, suck it up. You chose it. You chose this path. Let's get it done. You got people who love you, who are working their tails off. You need to do the same thing.
It makes a lot of sense. And I know a lot of artists, you know, starving artists is a trope, but not necessarily by choice. You know, a lot of people are like, oh, Picasso wasn't famous and rich until he was dead. And, you know, with you having a wife and a lot of people supporting a family, you know, that sentiment is anecdotal and it's great, but it, like you said, it doesn't exactly solve the problem. So like you said, working for it and owning it and knowing that you work in the industry really means that you're kind of ingrained. Like you're really, you're dedicated to it.
Yeah. It's my dog. Yeah, the starving artist trope is romantic and sexy for a very finite amount of time. When I was younger, I couldn't wait to go sleep on floors and random people's couches. And there's still, Lord knows, plenty of that when we go on tour. But I think that was when I wrote Living Wage, that was the time in my life where I decided that I need to get serious about music. And I thought I had been serious. You know, I think a lot of artists mistake working really, really hard and burning the candle on both ends as being serious about it. And there's a difference between that and working really smart. So I think that was the first step in me saying, well, if you're going to make a profession out of this, you have to treat it like a job. It's going to be incremental. You have to keep it consistent. You have to keep it uniform. I think that whole shift, you know, it ended up with me getting my manager right now, which is a huge benefit for me and really changed a whole lot. It was kind of that confluence of starving artist and okay, well, let's actually like move forward in life. Let's try and get things done because it's not just myself that I'm worried about, and I'm trying to be a good partner, and I'm trying to provide, and yeah, all of that was mixed in there. So a lot of emotions when I wrote that song.
Well, it shines through, and like I said, I think a lot of people resonate with that for any number of reasons, but being in the industry, I heard it and I was like, okay, I see exactly where you're coming from.
Yeah.
So with that being said, the single's out. You're talking about kind of pushing everything yourself here. Why don't you tell us what's next? What's in the pipeline? What are we looking for in 2020 for the rest of the year from you, from Will Overman?
That is a great question. Let me tell you that. My manager and I are racking our brains and reading every article we can read from other artists and whatnot about what to do with the album. We had it slated for the fall. Then the pandemic hit, and I think myself, as well as every other musician in the world, pressed pause and is now like, what in God's name do we do? Because there's no handbook for how to handle this. I mean, and you guys as a venue, this is really tough. You've got to recalibrate your brain. You've got to figure things out in a much different capacity because you're going to be releasing music in a much different capacity. So to answer your question without being unbelievably vague, we're trying to figure out the next step. We've got a single coming out soon. This whole process has forced me to pursue creative and not only different creative endeavors, but also music from different angles. I'm starting a podcast that we've been working on soon. Like I said, I'm doing all the visual elements of this album. So I'm not totally sure when the album's coming out. It's done. It's been done for a while now. But I'm just trying to figure out the best way to release it. And I wish I could tell people more because I can't wait for it to get out there. Every artist says they're most proud of their current album, but as they should be, but I'm really stoked on this one.
Well, and I think it's important, like you said, to be flexible, to be forgiving to yourself. You know what I mean? This is the time that no one's been in before. And, you know, sometimes it's a great time to explore some other interests, like you said about the podcast. I mean, I would listen to that, I think, just based on knowing how many similar interests we have. But, you know, this series as a whole for Bright Box started because we said, look, we still want to talk with artists. We still want to reach out to our fans. We still want to let them know what's going on. And, you know, we've easily had so much fun with this already that this will be something we continue well into once we get back to business as normal. So, you know, yeah. The silver lining for us was, what are additional ways that we can hang out with people, you know, in a non-traditional way? What is other ways besides selling the ticket that we can provide something? So, you know, it means so much mm-hmm. that we're having artists like you come on and talk about all these great experiences, because that's really the goal is, you know, we're trying to get to know you better and we're trying to give our fans something to look forward to. And like I said, I mean, Bill sent me your music. Geez, we had you scheduled already. And I thought, okay, I'm looking forward to this. And then so many shows, I thought, okay, a few more months. I can wait a few more months. I can wait, you know, yeah. 6 more months. Yeah. I can wait for this. So it's important. But like you said, I think what I've learned a lot is, you know, be kind to yourself. And like you said, look for other things you can do still with your music. Like the podcast, I think, is going to be a great thing. I'm looking forward to it.
Thanks, man. I'm so glad. Yeah, and to add to your point, it's as far as venues reaching out, and you guys are doing stuff like this, and it's so cool. I think the sense of community within the music scene, especially in Virginia, I can't speak for other states, but it seems like people are really coming together, not physically, but in other ways. And I think it's made people, from the musicians to the fans, really, really appreciative of what they have in the state and this region. And I'm hopeful, and I really believe that people on the other side of this thing are going to come out, and I think they're going to appreciate live music in a way they didn't before.
I totally agree. Well, Will, I want to thank you for being here, man. The next time I'll see you will be on stage, and I absolutely cannot wait. Thanks for chatting with us.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
See ya.
What's going on, everybody? My name is Will Overman. It's great to be a part of the Bright Box series here. I'm simultaneously running video and sound and watching my dog walk around all the camera gear right now. So here goes nothing. Again, thanks for having me. I'm going to start things off with my most latest single. It's called Living Wage. I wrote it down in North Carolina about a year ago. My wife and I were living down there, and I was jobless, had no prospects of a job, had no money, was trying to figure things out, and had a lot of time to write. So I wrote this song, and kind of wrote it for all the struggling musicians out there. And ironically, it means something completely different to me now, and I think it means something different to the world at this time. So my manager and I, we decided we would release it back in April, because I feel like a lot of folks right now are trying to figure out how to make a living wage, and that's what this song's called. So I hope you guys enjoy it. Waking up as she walks away, a promise is a lie without a plan. Left me with the dog and a cold cup of coffee made, and all day to think on ways I could be a better man. Christmas on credit, rents weekly. Can't afford to buy beer, but I'm drinking champagne. It's time to shut up, time to show out. I got a real good heart and the know-how. Time to piece it all together and find out from what I made. Time to get straight. Time to show that woman I mean wanna see. Put a ring on her finger. If I can live on love, her smile would be my living wage. And she is a song I hum when I'm afraid. Adrian, where Rocky gets beat. Gave me a heart, then she gave me a soul, and everything between. And I asked for nothing, just said follow your dreams. She pays the bills, I take out the trash. It's not a fair trade, but it's where we're at. It's time to shut up, time to show out. Got a real good heart and the know-how. Time to piece it all together and find out from what I made. Time to get up, time to get straight. Time to show that woman I mean wanna say. Put a ring on a finger and I'm already halfway. If I can live on love, her smile would be my living way. Living on the road, my friend, I'll keep you free and clean. Same thing. could ever sing. It's time I shut up, time I showed out. I got a real good heart, baby, I'm trying to know how. It's time to get up, time to get straight, time to show that woman I mean what I say. Put a ring on her finger and I'm already halfway. Put a ring on her finger and I'm already halfway. Living with. All right, you guys, new guitar for this one. I released this single back in February for Valentine's Day. It's a love song. And that's about all the background I have for this one. It's called Something to Hold, and it's done pretty well on the streaming platforms. I've been really stoked to see it take off, and I hope you guys enjoy this solo version, and go check out the full band version sometime too. Thanks, guys. She's the morning, she's the first light of day, shining through my window, brightening me awake. She's the t-shirt that is mine, my attention that is hers. When she's reaching for the covers, don't confuse her for a girl. Find a river, my hand, amen. I'm searching hard for something beautiful. Oh, she is the promised land. She gives me something. She gives me something I can hold on to. She gives me love, 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 like a summer afternoon. I give her something. I give her something she can hold on to. Giving love, I give her love, love, love is all she needs to make it through. Child fed to be tied, an outlier in an aggregation. But now she's waiting, oh, waiting tables at the steak and chicken. But if she could see what she means to me, then she'd have no reservations. She gives me something. She gives me something I can hold on to. She gives me love, 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 like a summer afternoon. I give her something, I give her something she can hold on to. I give her love, 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 I give her love, oh, oh, I give her love, I give her love. I give her something she can hold on to. All right, y'all, this is going to be my last song. Thank you guys so much for tuning in, wherever you are, on your couch, on your bed, in your kitchen, wherever. Hopefully we can do this in person one day, sooner than later. I miss concerts a whole lot. and I'm sure you guys do too. But thank you to Bright Box for doing this. Anything to get the music out there, it goes a long way, and I really appreciate those guys doing this. And I had a great interview with them. So thank you guys again so much for everything. That's my mic. My dog's sleeping in front of me, so he's really into this right now. And yeah, again, thank you guys. This next song is called Rock Salt Nails. It's not my song. It's by Utah Phillips, one of my favorite songs of all time. It's sad as hell, and I love playing it. I don't know what happened to Utah, but some woman broke his heart, and he penned a good one after that. So hope you guys enjoy it. I'm Will Overman. Y'all take care of yourselves, and hopefully I'll see you in person soon. Are so lonely, Lord, sorrow runs deep, and nothing is worse than these nights without sleep. Now walk out here alone. Yeah.
Jonathan Byrd is a preacher's son, a Gulf War veteran, and an award-winning songwriter from Chapel Hill, North Carolina. Known for his literary outsider songs that become campfire favorites, the Chicago Tribune called Jonathan Byrd one of the top 50 songwriters of the past 50 years. Very excited to have you here today. Thanks for joining us, Jonathan.
Thanks, Josh.
Have you been? Are you well?
I've been great. I've never been better. Yeah. It's considering especially how kind of crazy the times are. I'm doing very well.
Very good. So, I mean, I've got to ask, you know, you're known for these songs that are such compelling stories. They're kind of narrative tales of life and love and death in America. I mean, Lakota Sioux alone sold me on you as an artist. I've got to ask, where does that songwriting skill, where does that storytelling come from?
Well, that song in particular, I have to tell you, that's not my song. That is a song that belongs to Matt Fockler, who's from Sioux Falls, South Dakota, or Montrose, outside of Sioux Falls. And Matt is one of my favorite songwriters of all time. He's not a professional songwriter. He's a construction worker kind of, and a dad and just a cool guy that I met at a festival and has a bunch of great songs. And we recorded two of his songs on our last record. One was Lakota Sioux and the other one was Do You Dream? But I am known as a storytelling songwriter. And I don't know, stories make sense to me. When I first started getting serious about writing songs, I think I was listening mostly to stories. I was listening to old-time music and all the songs written by Anonymous. Those are all my favorite songs. And I listened to like Parchman Prison Farm recordings of Stacker Lee and stuff like that. And there was always a story there. Even if it wasn't entirely clear what the story was, there were obviously characters, and you could tell what the struggle was. And so I was attracted to that as a budding songwriter. I mean, I'd written songs in high school and I'd written goofy love songs and stuff. But when I got serious about it is when I discovered this sense of story that could be in a song in the way that those traditional stories are.
Yeah, it's a beautiful style of narration. It's a modern day bard in a lot of ways. And like I said, it's one of those styles where if I close my eyes, I really see the picture clearly and kind of what it means to me. And I think that's just beautiful.
I think that's beautiful too, and in fact, a lot of what I talk about when I'm teaching is how little is actually there. Like there's a song I have called "The Ballad of Larry," and it's a story about an old guy that I meet at a store, and I just kind of notice how he is, and he's a veteran, and he's kind of beat up, and he's buying some cigarettes and some beans, and then I go home. And I've got this piano that I put in the paper because I got it for free and I'm trying to fix it up and I want to give it away. So then this guy that I met at the grocery store shows up to buy the piano. And when I really analyzed this song and thought about using the song as an example to teach, I realized I never even described the man. I don't tell you what color his skin is, what color his eyes are, his hair, how tall he is, how much he weighs, what he's wearing, nothing. I describe what he buys. And I describe the things that he does. And so what that does, I think, and this was not conscious. I wasn't thinking forward like this when I wrote the song, you understand. But when I examined what worked about the song, I realized it allows the listener to come into the song and to create the world, to co-create the world of the song with me as a writer and as a performer. So then when I sing that song for 300 people in a room, 500 people in a room, there's 500 different interpretations of what is happening and of what there's 500 different Larrys living in people's heads.
It's amazing. But I mean, I guess it's no surprise because you're not new to this. I mean, you've been playing music since you were a kid, right? So do you have any early childhood memories of music? Is there something that's lasted?
Oh, yeah. There was always music. And I realized when my mother was holding my grandson and rocking him and singing hymns, I realized, like, that's what she did with me. She held me and rocked me and sang hymns. I don't remember that, but I know she did that. And then she played piano for the Baptist church that my dad preached in. So there was always that music. Then my brother had a guitar, and he loved sort of classic rock stuff. He bought, you know, the new Pink Floyd record when it came out, and he would learn the songs. My mother's sisters liked to sing, and they liked beach music and dancing. So there was always music around. Music was just a part of my life, always. And I started playing the piano very early and playing my brother's guitar very early, and just being experimental with music very early.
Yeah, I think that's always the case for a lot of musicians I've heard, is that lifelong love is almost generational. It's passed down. It's everything but, if not, a family band. You know what I mean? There's always these parts to fill in the gap and to hang out. And I think that's probably a really beautiful bonding experience that you've had that some others don't have the luck to have.
Yeah, I think the melodies of those hymns also are just woven into the fabric of my music. There's no escaping them for me.
Yeah, I think there's something about songwriting and storytelling specifically that feels ageless. You know what I mean? I mean, if you're a good storyteller, sometimes it's hard to distinguish that the song was written in, you know, the 1800s, the 1900s, or today when you tell a story.
We're made out of stories. Humans are made out of stories. That's how we process the world. That's how we understand everything. That's how we understand this disease that we're dealing with right now. That's how we understand civic unrest and what you think about it and how you feel about it and who you're behind and who you care about. All those things are built on stories. Stories are the way that we think about the world, and they're really the way that we construct our lives.
Yeah, I think it's important to note how a story is presented. And for me, it kind of led us to that question of, you know, you've typically performed and recorded as Jonathan Byrd and the Pickup Cowboys. But, you know, your first couple releases were technically as a solo artist. So, you know, when you were writing those first songs, did you always hear them as a full band in your head, or is that something that came later?
I don't often think about that when I'm writing a song. I don't often think about whether this is going to be a solo or a band performance. Every now and then I do. Sometimes I'll write something on the bass or on a keyboard, and I'll imagine this being a part of something larger every now and then, but not very much. Usually I think if I can't play on the guitar, then it's just not, I'm just not going to play it. But I saw the Eurythmics on the Arsenio Hall show. So what was that? I don't know what that's, the 90s or something. But they, the two of them, Annie Lennox, and I can't remember his name, I'm terrible with names, but he's incredible. The two of them and his guitar, they did a show. They played two or three songs with just him playing the guitar and her singing, and it was awesome. And I realized, yeah, it doesn't matter if you make electronic records. You should be able to play the song on a guitar.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's inherently the most stripped down and the most core of the song is going to be that. And, you know, I've seen bands that are 2 pieces to 10 pieces, and often I can think about what that would sound stripped down to 2 versus, you know, beefed up to 10. But I mean, right. I guess with that being said, is there any of your songs, like if you had to pick one right now that you could fully orchestrate, maybe put a whole 30-piece band behind, is there one that comes to mind for you?
Actually, I just made a record, a couple of years ago I made a record with a group called The Sentimentals from Denmark. And they got together with a chamber ensemble. It's an 8-piece chamber ensemble. And we went and recorded live in their space. They have their own performance
That's
hall.
So cool.
And we went and we just set up on stage as if we were performing and mic'd up. And we recorded with this chamber ensemble with a harp, piano, string section, reeds, woodwinds. And it was gorgeous. And we actually hired an arranger. She's in L.A. She was incredible to work with. And she put the arrangements together for the ensemble. So I'm hearing those songs right now, and I'm actually learning some of those songs again from the record to be able to perform them with my band, which is just a sort of electric trio. But they work that way as well. But those songs I'm hearing in my head right now when you say, can you picture arranging this? I'm hearing that music.
That's amazing. So, I mean, it seems like you're not short of experiences. You've done solo, you've worked with these large groups, you've got you and the Pickup Cowboys, which is the day-to-day for sure. So again, what's next? What does Jonathan Byrd got coming down the pipeline for us?
Oh, probably a collaboration, because that's what I always do. I always collaborate with people. Right now, I kind of accidentally got into photography because we started this live stream, and I didn't really know how a camera worked. I was just, we were using my phone. And I was like, well, how does my phone even work? Like, the lens is really small, but it's kind of, it gets a wide angle, and I have to put it here, and it doesn't do that thing where some things are out of focus and some things are in focus. It doesn't do that thing. So what's that? So I bought a camera. I just bought like a good, but a, you know, an economical good camera, and started messing around with it and just couldn't get enough of it and still can't. And now I've bought another camera, a better camera. And I've sold pieces and I'm printing canvases. And I'm working with a couple people on a couple of different projects. So that, I might have a visual thing that comes out next. I've got a book of poetry that's already written that I just need to get to a publisher, I already have a publisher for it. And we have 6 tracks from Pickup Cowboy that weren't on the record. And they our bass player and cellist, who played with us at the Bright Box, by the way, Paul Ford played with us at the Bright Box. He passed away, but he is all over the record. So there's 6 songs recorded with him that haven't been released yet. And we're going to put that out as Pickup Takeout.
Well, and I think it's important to say that, you know, a lot of artists that I've talked to seem to have multiple outlets for creativity, or, you know, once you're inherent in creativity, it just kind of, it eeps out from you, you know what I mean? So it's funny to hear you say that you do photography, because I've talked to a few other songwriters specifically even that do photography, and you know, a few musicians I know do woodwork, and it's so cool to see it kind of come out in parts of your daily life. Like, I don't think you couldn't make art if you tried, and I think that's beautiful.
No. I actually tried having a job for a few years.
Who needs that?
No, doesn't work. So I contribute in my ways, you know. I love to collaborate, and I love to contribute. I like to help people. I like to be a part of something bigger. I like things that challenge me a little bit. And that's what we do with our live stream as well. So we live stream every Wednesday, 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern Time. Every Wednesday. We've been doing that for more than 2 years. We were way ahead of the curve on the live stream thing. So by the time lockdown happened, we had a 4-camera shoot. We had a professional audio mix just for the internet. And it's great. And we get to bring in virtual special guests. So we play for 3 hours. So at 8 o'clock and 9 o'clock, we have little 10-minute breaks. And we bring in virtual special guests. So I just write people and I say, could I pay you a little bit to make a couple of videos with your phone and send them, and we'll feature them during our show. That's been fun. Asking for requests from people or people suggesting things that we do live, and then working with that. All that stuff is just so much fun. And we really miss having our fans in the live audience, obviously, but being able to interact with them and having an internet like this right now is just amazing. It's a real blessing.
Well, I really thank you for taking the time to be here with us today. We'll definitely include the link to that live stream. It's really cool, you know, your setup that you're doing. It's important, I think, for a lot of people that, you know, the show must go on. But yeah, personally, you know, the next time I'll see you will be live on the stage, you know, and I can't wait.
Thanks, Josh.
All right, we'll see you later. Be well. All right.
Take care.
White Cross is known locally and regionally for our tractor pull. Every spring and every fall, hopefully every fall. The White Cross tractor pull. We even have a trophy around here somewhere. Where'd the trophy go? Where'd the trophy go? That's not mine. That belongs to a young lady by the name of Ella Bertram. She used to sit right here on the stairs. She used to sit right there on the stairs and watch me play, and she grinned at me when we played that song. And one night she said, I've got something for your altar. I said, all right, what you got? And she handed me that thing. I said, did you win the White Cross tractor pull? She said, yeah, when I was 14. I said, that's amazing. I'm definitely gonna put that on the altar. We're gonna have that up there all night. And when the show is over, I went to give her her trophy back. I said, thank you for letting us use your tractor pull trophy for our show. She said, no, you keep it. I got lots of them. That's marriage material here in Mike Cross. Woo! I wrote this song when I was on Mike Cross. She drove a farm all from 56. I never seen one do that before. She backed up to the sled and hitched, put in a distance and a little bit more. I met my baby at a tractor pull. Come on. I met my baby at a tractor pull. She dropped the hammer on my heart and soul. I met my baby at a tractor pull. I saw that woman and I lost the wheel. Going faster than I should have gone. Now I'm older and I got the feel, huh? I can pull steady all night long. I met my baby at a tractor pull. Come on. I met my baby at a tractor pull. She dropped the hammer on my heart and soul. I met my baby at a tractor pull. Make that old horse run like new. It ain't how fast, it's how far. We got a love that's built to last. Can't nobody compete with her, no. She's the only model in her class. I met my baby at the tractor pull. Sing along at home. I met my baby at the tractor pull. She dropped the hammer on my heart and soul. I met my baby at the tractor pull. One more time. I met my baby at the tractor pull. You know. I met my baby at the tractor pull. She dropped the hammer on my heart and soul. I met my baby at the tractor pull. Now, a song by request here. This is called Wild Ponies. We're coming to you, of course, from White Cross, North Carolina, just outside of Chapel Hill, which is the home of the University of North Carolina. That's the only state university in the United States to have graduated a class in the 18th century. And the most expensive place to park in the state of North Carolina. We're going to take you out to the coast, out to a beautiful chain of islands we call the Outer Banks. Places like Currituck, Kerala, Manteo, Whalebone, Kitty Hawk, Ocracoke Island, where Blackbeard lived and died. In fact, we were going to play a festival out there this summer, which is unfortunately canceled. We'd like to send a shout out to all our Ocracoke people. We'll see you next year. Known as the graveyard of the Atlantic. And as the Spanish made their way up the coast hundreds of years ago, they were shipwrecked, surprised by storms, stuck on sandbars and shoals, and they would jettison their horses in order to make the ships light enough to move again. They didn't always get all the horses back. The horses they didn't get back, the
They swam to shore. They learned how to eat salt grass. They dig pits in the sand with their hooves. They dig down 7 feet, 8 feet, 9 feet deep in places. They make big bowls for fresh water to seep into. That's how they survived out there for about 400 years now. They're still out there. We call them the wild ponies. She had legs like daggers and eyes like oceans, and her heart locked up in a hard combination. And I took her to the island to see the wild ponies. See, I had a friend who had a concrete boat. It don't take as much as you might think to float. He lived out on the island with the wild pony. We made a fire in the live oak trees and listened to the pirate breeze aboard. How a man could be so far from home and still know where he's going. She drifted down from a shipwrecked town and landed here on the Pamlico Sound. She'd heard out on gave all I could give to her, a chance to see what she had heard, and a night out on the island with the wild. Stay here like she didn't stay there, always looking for somewhere a little greener. Every time I see the ponies run, scared and hungry, wild and young, I see her. She died at drinking one night on the ocean side, swimming to freedom like a wild pony. Well, I wish her well, wish her peace. My head's got to be so free.